brought to you by Penguin.
Sexton Blake's Allies by Mark Hodder, read by Colin Mace. Baker Street, London. Brighter today, Sexton Blake announced as I entered his consulting room. A welcome respite from the rain. Come in, sit down. Would you care for some wine? Brandy, coffee, cigarettes, pipe. Blake seemed always to have an indulgence of one sort or another on the go. It hadn't occurred to me before, but this Epicurean aspect of his personality, whilst never being directly alluded to in any of the stories I'd read, was evident in the majority of them. It would have killed a normal man. Thank you, I said, taking up my, by now, customary position in the saddleback armchair opposite his own. He poured a generous glass of red and handed it to me. Good health, he murmured. The wine was superb, but I coughed and almost spluttered it out through my nose when there came a scratching at the door and it was pushed aside by an enormous bloodhound. Remarkably, the dog, a truly magnificent beast, shouldered the portal shut before padding across the room. It sniffed my hand, slumped onto the hearthrug, and gave a prodigious yawn. "Your mouth is hanging open," Blake observed. I thought he was addressing the hound. He wasn't. I stammered. It can't be Pedro. Surely it... A descendant of the original, Blake said. From a long and illustrious line, all specially bred and trained to emulate the talents of their late and lamented forebear. Surely it occurred to you that the Pedro of the later stories couldn't possibly be the same as the Pedro of the earlier. Yes, I suppose. As if I hadn't considered that the Sexton Blake of the 1960s couldn't possibly be the Sexton Blake of the 1890s. I gazed at Pedro. Sprawled and contented, he gazed back. Blake interrupted my inexpressible ruminations. What have you brought for me today? I turned my attention to my briefcase and withdrew from it a binder. As I passed it to him, I said, You touched on the subject as I was departing yesterday. Your allies. Splendid, he said. Happy memories. You told me that something called the credibility gap gave rise to the master crooks and also to those possessing the wherewithal to oppose them. Can you explain exactly what it is? He tasted his wine and pulled a cigar from his pocket. A brief exchange of micro-gestures clarified that, as on previous occasions, I had no objection to him smoking but no desire to do so myself. A theory of mine, he said, employing a tool to snip the end from his cigar. A state of consciousness wherein cognitive dissonance is so severe that a person experiencing it can find no means to cope with the unfamiliar and so develops what might be termed a blind spot in regard to it. Denial. In conjunction with this, a converse state arises that prospers under the same conditions and which employs incredulity to further its own ends. Thus, for example, the often very eccentric master crooks who thrived in the wake of the Great War, and the Scotland Yard men who could neither comprehend nor deal with them. And you, Mr. Blake, do you operate within this credibility gap? Most certainly, he answered, and his tone seemed to add, more than you will ever know. My allies and I managed to transcend the cognitive dissonance that was gripping the masses, or we at least achieved a high degree of functionality whilst under its influence. While Blake was speaking, I was scratching my ballpoint pen across my notepad at high speed. My handwriting a tangled scrawl. I couldn't write fast enough. Where food for thought was concerned, Blake was serving me a veritable banquet. Losely, I murmured. Sir Richard Losely was the first and one of the most notable of your supporters. He appeared in 1907. I had the author Cecil Hayter write up the cases in which he was involved. Losely was my oldest friend. We were at school and university together. I noted that slip, is, not was, and filed it away for later consideration. And the next to arrive on the scene, I went on, was the Honourable John Lawless, introduced by Andrew Murray in 1914. He put a match to his cigar and smiled. His surname was actually Lawless, but he thought the E made it more dashing than the I. John was what you might call the prototype of the gentleman adventurer. I was assisted by quite a few such fellows, but he was the most outstanding of them. I put my wineglass to my lips. Incredible flavours flowed over my tongue. My God, how much must this wine cost? Exactly how rich was Sexton Blake? He continued. However, don't overlook the women. They were ahead of their time. Yvonne Cartier. He stopped, and I was amazed to see him gripped by strong emotion. When he went on, his voice was slightly hoarse. I encountered her a year before, Lawless. She was a remarkably strong and resourceful woman. The author G.H.T. wrote about her with all the sentimentality of his time, but in truth, she surpassed every expectation of the period, and in many respects outmatched her male equivalents. There were others of her ilk, too. Mademoiselle Roxanne, I suggested, a very similar character. Forged by a very similar misfortune, he noted. One that in Yvonne's case initially made her an opponent rather than an ally. That's why I gave Lawless chronological precedence. I tapped my pen on the binder, but if we may, we'll return to Yvonne presently. Blake offered an insouciant wave of assent. Pedro's tail had started to thump enthusiastically on the rug. I grinned down at the dog. He recognizes the names of friends. How, though? Surely he's too young to have met them. Tone of voice, Blake said. Tinker and I often reminisce. I indicated that he should open the binder. For the first story in this selection, I've chosen an ally who worked in a more official capacity than most, James Granite Grant. The King's Spy, Blake said. He opened the cover. He often teamed up with Mademoiselle Julie of the French Secret Service. Where either or both of them were concerned, I gave my case notes to William Walter Sayer, who wrote under the pseudonym of Pierre Quirole. He examined the Union Jack story paper contained in the top plastic sleeve. This was an interesting affair. The Case of the Seventh Key. Granite Grant wasn't the only Secret Service agent you worked with, I said. Anthony Skeen introduced Julia Fortune. Anthony Parsons wrote of Beltham Brass and Yvonne de Brasilieu. Gwyn Evans's stories often featured the newspaper man, Derek Splash Page. Page was introduced in 1925, Blake said, which was actually 2 years after I'd met him. By 1927, he'd left the service. He found journalism more exciting. More exciting than being a secret agent? As a reporter, he had greater independence. I understood his need to play a free hand. Yet, you and Tinker were agents. After a fashion. Can you expand on that? It's better that I don't. Not fully fledged members of the service, then. Our role was fairly unique. Let's leave it there, unless you're willing to endure a rather intensive and not altogether enjoyable vetting process. I leaned away from him and raised a palm. No thanks. Granite Grant has obviously led me into dangerous territory. He frequently did the same to me. Blake lifted his glass and contemplated its contents. In a reflective tone, he said, Grant was one of the bravest men I ever met. Tremendously powerful and extraordinarily focused. A force of nature. Once he set his mind to something, he was akin to a runaway locomotive. If you ever found yourself standing in his path, you'd need to get out of the way, quick sharp. A good job you were running on the same tracks. I should have hated it to be otherwise. The Case of the Seventh Key by W. W. Sayer. Union Jack issue 1115, 1925. The first chapter. The Caller and the Key. The man who entered Sexton Blake's consulting room in Baker Street was a little below the average height, but of thick-set and sturdy appearance. A reddish, drooping moustache concealed his mouth, and his features were somewhat flat and characterless, except for a certain shrewd glint of his small, restless eyes. He was dressed inconspicuously, his clothes being a trifle threadbare, and altogether there was little about him to arouse one's interest or curiosity. Appraising his visitor with one of his swift, searching glances, Sexton Blake put him down at once as a foreigner, but was rather doubtful of his nationality. Neither could he answer the question when the newcomer spoke with just a faint, puzzling trace of accent. "You are the Mr. Sexton Blake referred to here?" he inquired, thrusting forward a newspaper and pointing with his finger. Blake casually noticed that his visitor's hand trembled, the only sign he gave of being mentally agitated. Glancing at the newspaper, Blake saw that it was that morning's issue of the Daily Mail. The article in question was concerned with the theft of a pearl necklace that had occurred at Kensington the previous night, and the paragraph to which his visitor pointed went as follows. "Doubtless the necklace has already been disposed of to a receiver of stolen property or a fence, to employ the term used by the criminal fraternity. These men openly carry on a legitimate trade as a blind to their unlawful but more lucrative enterprise, and although their illicit business is suspected, probably most of the fences in London are known to that shrewd investigator, Mr. Sexton Blake of Baker Street. Yet it is exceedingly difficult to catch them in the act of handling the stolen goods." Having perused this brief reference to himself, Blake glanced across at his visitor. "Yes," he admitted, "apparently I am the person referred to there, Mr. Falcon. John Falcon," interpolated the other. "Mr. Falcon," nodded Blake. "And is it concerning this stolen necklace that you have come to consult me, Mr. Falcon?" "No, no," replied his visitor somewhat hastily. "I know nothing about this stolen necklace. It does not concern me. But the paper says you are acquainted with men who receive stolen property. It was when I read that these men were known to you that I thought you might be able to help me."
"Help you in what way, Mr. Falcon?"
"By recovering something that I have lost, sir."
"I see," said Blake slowly. "You have lost some article that you have reason to suppose has been disposed of to a receiver of stolen property."
"I have been robbed," came the excited reply. "My pocket was picked less than an hour ago. I was in Mare Street at the time, having lunch. I know it must have happened then, because a moment before the things were in my pocket."
"Mare Street, Hackney?" said Blake reflectively. "And what things were taken from your pocket, Mr. Falcon?"
"Several things," replied the other vaguely. "There was a key," he added with some hesitation, "which I am very eager to recover. The other things don't matter so long as that is returned to me. That key is of no value to the thief, and I am prepared to give him £5 for its return, and to ask no questions."
"Mm-hmm," murmured Blake, "but I am afraid the key won't help us to get on the track of the thief, Mr. Falcon.
He certainly won't have taken the key to a fence, expecting to raise money on it."
"No, no.
I am aware of that. But there was something else. An old-fashioned pair of gold earrings, each set with a single diamond weighing about 2 carats. They were in a wash leather bag with the key."
"Ah, they certainly might help us to get on the track of the thief. Probably those earrings are already in the hands of a fence.
Was there anything else in the wash leather bag?"
"Nothing else, sir."
"Then that is the extent of your loss?"
"Not quite. I had 2 10-shilling notes in the same pocket. They were also stolen."
"In which pocket?" asked Blake.
"In this one," said Falcon, indicating the inner pocket of his coat.
"And you say the theft occurred in Mare Street, Hackney?"
"Yes. I was having lunch in a little eating house at the time. It was when I came to feel for my money that I discovered my loss."
"And what was the name of this eating house?"
"I did not notice the name. But there is a fire station immediately opposite. It was rather dark inside, and it was crowded at the time."
We hope you enjoyed this preview.
To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.